Divine Truth Frequently Asked Question Session. Jesus, Mary and others provide answers to questions that are frequently asked by members of the media and public. This presentation is part of the Partner Relationship Series. Jesus and Mary answer questions about bad habits that ruin good relationships. This session was recorded on the 27th of October 2015 in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia. This is session 4, part 2.
How does facade ruin my relationship?
Well, again, we have to look at what the purpose of facade in a relationship would be. And when you think about it, it's pretty devious purpose, isn't it, to maintain a facade in a relationship? Because mm-hmm. we really want the other person to have concepts and ideas about ourselves that are not true at all, and that we know are not true in many cases. Mm-hmm. Or we want to maintain our own opinion of ourselves, things about us that we know are not true. So, again, if we look at this purpose of a facade in a relationship, we can see that it's quite evilly motivated. Mm-hmm. And how can we then expect anybody who has a facade in a relationship to actually have a good relationship?
Yeah.
So let's have a look at some of the evil intents of the relationship, of the facade mm-hmm. first, and then we'll look at what it does.
Okay, so my facade, me maintaining a facade, helps me believe things about myself that are not true.
Mm.
So either that's because I want to be in denial, isn't it?
Correct.
About what's the truth about myself, or I believe that if I keep acting in a certain way in my facade, yep. then that will negate what I really feel underneath.
Yes.
Yep.
And oftentimes we're presenting this to other people, obviously, and to ourselves. So sure, it's one thing to fool another person, but fooling yourself is one of the most stupid things you can do, actually, if you're ever going to have a relationship with God in particular, and ever going to have a relationship with yourself, mm-hmm. even. Mm-hmm. It's one of the most stupid things you could ever attempt to do. So you definitely don't want to have a facade with yourself.
But we do it, and that's one of the reasons we do it, because yes. we just don't want to know the truth about ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Second, we want our partner to believe something about ourselves, which is not true, which you mentioned.
Very, very silly too, isn't it? If you think about it, we're basically encouraging our partner to develop a relationship with us based on them thinking that we're a certain person that we're not.
Mm-hmm.
mm. Now, sooner or later, when they find out that we're not the person they thought us to originally be, of course, the relationship will be destroyed.
Yeah.
So
we want a facade.
Yeah, not going to be very helpful to the relationship.
The third thing is that my facade demands that I actually keep believing something about my partner that isn't the truth.
Yes, because it basically assumes a number of things about your partner. For example, it assumes your partner's stupid. It assumes your partner wants you to be a certain way when they may not. It makes a number of very invalid assumptions about your partner. So you're actually wanting your partner to believe a whole heap of things. And you believe, in fact, that your partner believes a whole heap of things they may not believe.
So if we can explain that a little bit further, it's like me being in my facade,
mm-hmm.
In that facade and in my continual presentation of that facade, then I have to have the belief that you're going to accept that facade.
Correct.
And that you want that facade.
Correct.
And that you like that facade.
Correct.
Yeah.
And all three things may be completely wrong.
I see.
And also, I feel that it dishonors your partner, because you are quite strongly saying that your partner has no idea who the real you is. And if that's what your intent is, to dishonor your partner so much, to not even show them what your real person is, like what your real intent is, what your real nature is, then you're not thinking very much of your partner. You don't love your partner very much if that's what you wish them to believe.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So, but these are the reasons why we do have a facade. We don't want the truth about ourselves to Correct. Ourselves.
Correct.
We don't want our partner to know the truth about us.
Yes.
And we might believe that our partner likes this version
yes,
of ourselves.
We certainly like our version of ourselves.
Better.
Otherwise, we wouldn't do it. And we believe our partner should like this yeah. version of ourselves
yeah.
too.
Yeah.
Otherwise, yeah. we wouldn't present it to them.
Yes. Yeah. yeah. Okay, so that's why we do it.
That's why we do it.
Let's talk about why.
It's very manipulative. Yes. Very manipulative. So.
Yes, well, let's talk about that. Let's yes. talk about the fact that the facade is a form of manipulation.
Of course.
And what that does to a relationship.
Well, every time a person feels manipulated, they're not going to feel very close to the person who's manipulating them. Mm-hmm. So, you know, of course it's going to cause a break in the relationship. Like, if you present to me what I later find out to be completely untrue, mm-hmm. well, it's impossible for me to not also, in that moment, believe that you didn't attempt to manipulate me
yeah.
to get me to do a whole heap of things that I would not have normally done if I knew the truth.
Yeah, it's a way of controlling, isn't it? I'm going to control who I am, who I present myself to be and the truth about myself mm-hmm. in order to control how you might respond to whatever
yes.
I'm saying.
And the unfortunate truth is that if you had presented yourself as you truthfully are, I might not have even been interested in having this relationship.
Yeah.
So the whole relationship would be a lie. Mm-hmm. And then what, you would expect that person who's been on the receiving end of that manipulation to be happy about it? I don't think so.
So let's play devil's advocate a little bit here, because you're saying if I presented the truth about how I really feel, then you might not have liked it and you might not have wanted to be in a relationship with me. Wouldn't that be ruining my relationship? Isn't it better to keep up my facade?
No, that's not ruining anybody's relationship. You haven't got a relationship at that point.
Yeah.
There's no relationship to ruin.
Because from a soul perspective,
the only motivation for doing it is selfish. Mm-hmm. You want something from the other person and you know you can get it as long as you present something that's not true.
Mm-hmm.
That's manipulation and it's selfishness. You're being selfish.
Mm.
Presenting a facade to somebody else while you're having a relationship with them is complete selfishness. It's only self-motivated.
Yeah. So the effects of selfishness on a relationship then are?
Well, you could go on for quite a few days about the effect of selfishness on a relationship. But we'll probably cover that in another.
I suppose what I'm getting at is that from a soul perspective, the damage is being done. You mentioned that this damage is, it's quite unpleasant, obviously, for the partner to find out later that a facade has been presented to them. But even during the act of presenting the facade, there's no soul opening or connection in that, is there? So from God's perspective, there's not even really a relationship.
Well,
is that
a facade
right?
is not your soul. It's your intellectual manufacture of what you believe yourself to be. It's not mm-hmm. who you really are. So what a person's getting from you in the relationship is they get to feel who you really are, and then what you're presenting at them to be is completely different to what they feel you really are. So for a start, there's a lot. They have to be willing to accept a lot of lies to stay in a relationship with you. And a person who's willing to accept a lot of lies is probably also willing to give a lot as well of lies as well.
Mm-hmm.
And so at the end of the day, you're basically having an imaginary relationship.
Yeah.
Like it's just a figment of your imagination.
Yeah.
It doesn't really exist. Because as soon as you presented your real self, what would happen then? Right? Now, if you presented your real self to a person who truly loved you and wanted your real self, then of course they'd be very happy with that.
Yeah.
But if you presented your real self to a person who only wants to see what you're lyingly presented to them, then of course they're going to leave you probably immediately, mm-hmm. I would suggest. And that's the reason, one of the reasons why you're doing it. But it's stupid because it doesn't create any emotional intimacy. There's no potential for growth and there's no potential for any closeness on any level, really. Like, so yeah, it's a very pointless exercise. And yet we see the majority of people do it.
Yes.
It's very, very sad.
Yeah, yeah. So within that, you've just mentioned that the desire for facade is a lack of desire for truth, essentially.
Mm.
And it is, in fact, lying.
Of course it's lying. And mm-hmm. oftentimes, knowingly.
Yeah.
Not just unwittingly.
Yeah.
Knowingly lying. Knowing that you're not the person you're presenting yourself to be is lying.
Yeah.
It's quite straight, you know. And again, like I said, only motivated by selfishness, mm-hmm. because you want something in return. That's the only reason why you do it.
And it has a flow-on effect, doesn't it? That I actually, if I present a facade, I'm lying to you constantly, mm-hmm. I diminish your capacity to make free will choices about, informed choices, really, about
what's
going on.
That's the other thing. I'm severely impacted upon the free will of another person by being in a facade.
Yeah.
I am, any lie perpetrated towards another stops them from being informed to make proper decisions. So whenever I'm presenting a facade, I'm purposefully manipulating their will, mm-hmm. right? Now, from God's perspective, one of the only gifts that God has given to humankind is the gift of free will. Like, there are a couple of gifts God's given. One of them is free will.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you think about it, from God's perspective, how important is free will? It's sacramount to yeah. God. It's like, it's one of the most important things that you could honor in a relationship. And when you're presenting a facade, you are in complete dishonor of the gift of free will.
Mm-hmm.
You are basically manipulating the person's decision-making process. That's what you're doing. And you're wanting to do it,
yeah.
which is a very dark and evil behavior. And even if you're doing it because you already believe that facade of yourself, well, like I said, that's paramount to stupidity. Believing mm-hmm. something about yourself that deep down is not true is just crazy as well.
Yeah.
So I just feel a lot of people have huge amounts of self-delusion when it comes to this facade issue and how big it is in their life mm-hmm. and how dangerous and negative it is in terms of the development of their soul condition.
Yeah.
And of course, how dangerous it is to their relationship.
Mm.
Sooner or later, somebody's going to find out the truth. And when they do, you're going to find that those people are not going to be very happy.
Mm. Absolutely. And this is not just about things, the actual events that we're lying about. It's about the nature of who we are, isn't it? What we really feel, what we really want. A lot of times in relationships, people are just presenting a complete facade about
all those things,
their opinions, their likes, their dislikes, all of these things.
But sooner or later in a relationship, pressure comes,
mm-hmm.
right? And when the pressure comes, that's when you start to see the person's true nature, right? And if they're presenting a facade to other people and you notice it, then they're bound to be presenting a facade with you.
Yeah.
And if they're lying to other people, they're bound to be lying to you. Right? We can't expect any different.
Yeah.
And if those things are happening, this is all about the character and nature of the individual. Their character, which is a primary importance in a relationship. And it's one thing that we notice most people don't focus on at all. They're not concerned about character. They're only concerned about sexual attraction, attractiveness, you know, physical attractiveness of some kind, and everything being safe and secure and financially
stable. And sense of humour seems to...
Oh, your sense of humour rates high.
Yeah.
And none of that has anything to do with character. None of it. And if you don't enter a relationship wanting for there to be a development of character, then of course relationships are going to just disappear quite rapidly as a result.
Yeah.
And from God's perspective, the development of your character is one of the most important things you can do.
Yeah.
And by the way, if you want to have a close relationship with a partner, it's also one of the most important things you can do.
Yeah.
And developing a facade is the opposite of developing character.
And we've pretty much covered the final point, which is that you can't give or receive love. If I'm in my facade, I cannot give you love and I cannot receive love from you.
No, because love comes from the soul of the person to the other person's soul and vice versa. For you to receive love from a person, it has to enter your soul. It can't enter through your facade or through your addictions, which is what your facade's all based around protecting.
Mm-hmm.
And if you are not having this soul-to-soul based loving exchange, there's no love present.
It's almost like, isn't it, like my facade is a cardboard cutout of me that I keep presenting to you, and I can't, there's no emotional flow of real soul. This is where my soul actually is, and that's where the real relationship would happen.
Yeah.
But if I'm asking you to continually interact with this cardboard version of myself,
mm-hmm.
there's no love that's going to flow out of you into me or out of me into you, is there?
Well, that person that you put up is a fiction of your own imagination or your own desire for me to imagine it. And either way, I'm just having a relationship with someone I imagine you are.
Yeah.
And that obviously means that it's not a real relationship.
Yeah.
And it's incapable of becoming one while it happens.
Yeah.
So it's very, very dangerous to your relationship, a facade. And in fact, it's very dangerous to any relationship, but very dangerous to your relationship with a partner who's going to be with you for, hopefully, for a large portion of your life.
Mm-hmm.
And I find it interesting because most of the time people enter these kind of relationships at the beginning because they think it's only going to be temporary anyway.
Mm.
Right? And so they present a facade thinking the whole thing's going to be temporary relationship. They get a bit of sex out of the facade and then they go on their merry way, right?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that's why a lot of these kind of relationships start. Unfortunately, though, people get trapped in the addictions of relationship after that and find themselves in the relationship for a long period of time trying to maintain a facade, which is quite difficult.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. And, of course, if we allow our partner, we've been speaking about ourselves in facade, but if we allow our partner to be in a facade with us, we're basically, all of these issues that then apply in the reverse, really, don't they?
And if we know it's true that they are presenting a facade and we're still accepting it, then that says a lot about our character.
Yeah.
It says a lot about our willingness to actually accept the lie.
Mm-hmm.
And it's highly likely that in accepting that lie, we probably also perpetrate quite a number of our own.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, it's a demonstration of our poor character by accepting it.
Yeah, because often we're content with that because we're getting what we want.
Correct.
From that person denying themselves or presenting different feelings to us or different desires to us. We selfishly want what we want and we don't even care enough about that person to challenge them and say, hey, you actually feel something different here.
Yes.
Yeah.
And how can I, you know, receive from you what I would like to have when I'm knowing that you're just putting something on, you know?
Mm.
It's like, yeah, I have always found facade-based relationships very, very difficult,
mm-hmm.
which is the reason perhaps why I don't have too many relationships. But, you know, and I'm not talking about partner relationships there. I even mean facade relationships with people who are in a facade when they talk to you.
Mm-hmm.
It's impossible to maintain a relationship with them in the long run for so many reasons. So if you want to stay in a facade-based relationship, you're going to find most probably that unless your partner is willing to do exactly the same as you are, that your relationship will be utterly destroyed in the long run.
Mm.
And as soon as you pass into the spirit world, it's going to be destroyed anyway because you'll both see what you truly are.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's never going to be fulfilling if both of you are content to be in a facade. It will feel very hollow and...
It's just a facade-based bartering system.
Yeah.
You know, why would you want such a relationship in the first place? It says something about your character, even if you wanted such a relationship in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, though, most people want it for other reasons, like for safety, security, financial safety, security, sexual feelings, you know.
Mm-hmm.
There's usually an ulterior motive that is quite prominent for a relationship to stay in facade for a long period of time.
Okay,
terrible for your relationship, another thing. So you can see why we've talked about a lot of these emotions before, and you can see now the effect that they would have on any relationship, including your relationship with God, of course, but relationship with a partner, just as damaging to your relationship with your partner as they would be to your relationship with God.
Yeah, and as you mentioned in the introduction to this session, it's that relationship with a partner that often becomes our primary relationship. We don't have God in our lives necessarily. We don't necessarily have many other people who are in our life every single day for a long period of time.
Mm.
And so this is the area where there's the potential for so much harm to our soul condition, so much unhappiness to grow and grow and grow. And conversely, if we deal with these issues that we're discussing in this session, then the opportunity for love and happiness to grow exponentially.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So again, another big thing to avoid.
Yes. You know,
bad habit to avoid. and unfortunately, for many people who are in facade, it's such an ingrained habit. Yep. It's automatic.
Yep.
They've done it for such a long time. They're so good at it, or they think they are.
Yeah.
And if you're sensitive emotionally, you feel it immediately. But if you're not sensitive emotionally, you'll take the bait.
Yeah.
You will. And it's sad that the majority of people on earth are so insensitive emotionally that anybody on earth with a facade finds life quite easy.
Yeah.
It should be the opposite way around. Anybody in a facade on earth should find life very difficult. If we were all emotionally sensitive, we'd instantly be able to feel when a person's in a facade, and it would not attract us at all.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel the facade, you know, the way to combat a facade from an exterior perspective is to be emotionally sensitive. As soon as you're emotionally sensitive, you can feel that what a person's saying to you is completely different to what they feel towards you,
yeah. And
therefore not worth trusting. Mm.
In order to become emotionally sensitive, though, you're going to have to do your own work on your facade. And it's
certainly,
it's powerful work and very worthwhile to look at sincerely breaking it down, because you confront a lot of investments and a lot of fears and a lot of really damaging emotions. And and in doing it, it's very freeing as
yes.
well.
In our upcoming assistance groups in 2016-18, we're going to have a little section on the facade self in the second group, but we're going to have much larger section of understanding the sin,
yes,
and then dealing with the sin, because a facade creates a lot of sin,
yeah.
And we need to understand what's going on with our facade and the powerful effects it has negatively on our soul condition and on our life.
Okay, thank you. How does untruthfulness ruin my relationship?
Well, we've just done a session about how facade ruins our relationship.
Yeah.
And you could pretty much say identical things about how untruthfulness yeah. ruins your relationship.
Because the facade is really an
desire to be untruthful.
Untruthful state, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah. Yeah. There are some areas I feel here that are in addition to the facade, because the facade is like presenting yourself to be something that you're not. Whereas untruthfulness is usually also about withholding truth mm-hmm. from the person for particular reasons.
So actual things about events and
yeah.
Occurrences that we do not want to disclose.
Correct.
Yeah.
So what we need to do is look at, again, the motivation, the mm-hmm. purpose behind someone being dishonest in the yep. relationship. And none of the purposes are good, but let's have a look at them.
What if I run through them quickly? Yeah.
Yeah.
So the purpose of dishonesty in a partner relationship, yeah. Dishonesty helps me believe things about myself that are not true.
Correct.
Dishonesty with my partner causes them to believe what I want them to believe about me.
Mm-hmm.
Dishonesty demands that I remain believing things about my partner that are not true.
So in other words, when my partner's dishonest with me, he's forcing me into believing things that are not true about him.
Yeah. My dishonesty is a form of manipulation and control.
Mm.
My partner's dishonesty is a form of manipulation and control of me.
Yeah.
My dishonesty does not honour the free will of my partner.
No. And my partner's dishonesty obviously doesn't honour my free will.
Yeah.
So we can see, well, there's a lot of reasons why we do it.
Yeah.
But a lot of negative effects too.
Yeah.
Like, the primary reason, I suppose, is that most people don't want to take responsibility for how they really feel or what they really thought or how they really acted.
Yeah.
And so what they try to do is lie about how they really feel, lie about what they really thought, and lie about how they really acted.
Yeah.
In order to maintain a semblance of a relationship. And I say semblance because as soon as you've done that, lied, as soon as you've lied, you've now broken the relationship anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So all you've got now is an imaginary relationship. And so that's all you're maintaining is an imaginary relationship.
Yeah.
The reality is a real relationship is based upon truth at all times. So if you're lying, then you no longer have a real relationship. And from God's perspective, you don't have one.
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't matter whether you're married or not. You're not in a relationship from God's perspective if you're untruthful with your partner about what you think, feel, and act
mm-hmm.
like.
Yeah. And this is very important, isn't it? We're not just talking about direct lies here. We're talking about withholding truth, skimming on some of the details.
Purposefully exaggerating, yep. Purposefully under-exaggerating,
yep.
Purposefully telling truths by what I would classify as selection.
Yep.
In other words, you selectively say a truth because you yep. know it would be manipulative, but you withhold a certain portion of that information yep. because you know if the person got the rest of the information, they'd probably act differently.
Mm-hmm.
And this is all about manipulation and control, of
course.
It
is. And it also goes down to waiting for my partner to ask me about something rather than just volunteering the truth
yes.
myself.
Yes. The lack of transparency
yeah.
in the relationship. And most people believe that telling the truth, that a lie mm-hmm. is not telling the truth when asked.
Yeah.
But from God's perspective, a lie is you allowing someone to believe the truth even if they haven't asked.
Yeah.
So at yeah. the end of the day, very destructive to relationships, all done for the selfish purpose of avoiding some kind of responsibility for how you've thought,
mm-hmm.
spoken, mm-hmm. or acted, or felt.
Or felt.
And in the end, your selfishness will destroy your relationship.
Yeah.
It will.
So let's talk about the effects.
Mm.
It's, as you've mentioned, it's an attempt to manipulate and control my partner or their
yes.
responses to me.
Yes.
So obviously that has a hugely negative effect on any connection that you might have and how the partner feels in relation to me.
Well, it might not at the time you do it, but mm-hmm. when they find out, which mm-hmm. inevitably God's laws are trying to expose
yeah.
them finding out,
yeah.
which so eventually they will find out. And when they find out, honestly, terrible disaster to your relationship.
Yeah.
So you're better off not doing it at all.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yep.
Rather than just trying to not find out something, yeah. you're better off telling them right up front, this is what I did.
Yeah.
Let the relationship do what it has to do at that point.
Yeah.
Rather than covering it over for years and years and then finding out later. And by that stage, they'll have so much resentment for it that it's highly unlikely your relationship will recover.
Mm-hmm. It's also a betrayal of trust, isn't it? So it breaks
yes.
trust. It means that trust cannot grow. And even I've found people who are
yep.
constantly untruthful themselves find it difficult to even trust their partner.
Of course they do,
yeah.
because they believe their partner is lying to them as much as they lie to their partner,
yeah.
right? Which is an understandable belief given the fact that they lie to their partner all the time
yeah.
and therefore assume that everybody must do the same. And yes, it's terrible. Betrayal is a great word here.
Mm-hmm.
It is a betrayal of trust. You are entering your relationship with a certain degree of guarantee, of promise that you're going to have no betrayal of your partner
mm-hmm.
in a number of different areas.
Mm-hmm.
And when you do, of course, they're not going to be very happy about the result.
Yeah.
And of course, betraying trust takes a lot of time to then repair trust because you've already betrayed it. And that indicates you already have a tendency to betray it,
mm-hmm.
which indicates that unless you're willing to deal with the emotional reason why you betrayed it, you will probably betray trust again. And so, yeah, that has a terribly negative effect on the long-term side of the relationship.
Yeah. And as you've just alluded to, it stops any real intimacy.
Of course.
Again, the soul, as we talked about in the facade, there's no soul-based interaction going on because
no.
we're presenting something that's not even coming from us from a truthful soul-based perspective.
Yes.
We're inventing a fabrication in order to try and have a relationship, but that's completely impossible because...
Yes, it creates suspicion
yeah.
inside of the relationship.
Yeah.
And when you start suspecting each other inside of a relationship, there isn't much hope for the relationship after that point.
Yeah. And because we're basing everything on deceit,
mm-hmm.
There's just like an imaginary relationship, isn't there?
Of course. And if anyone, again, was sensitive emotionally, they could feel the deceit. They could feel mm-hmm. the attempt for deceiving coming out of the person. The more sensitive you are emotionally, the more you can feel the intent of a person.
Mm-hmm.
So you feel not only their condition as they are right now, but also their intentions, what they intend to do in the future. And with a person who wants to lie, a person who's emotionally sensitive can feel they want to lie. that they'll be induced into lying under any circumstances, selfishly yeah. motivated. And having a relationship with such a selfish person is almost impossible.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, so that's why a relationship with a liar is very, very difficult to maintain unless you yourself are a liar or easily accept the lie.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm. Dishonesty also severely degrades our personal soul condition, doesn't it?
Yes, it has a major impact. Again, all of these things we're raising have a major impact upon our soul condition. But lying, you know, being dishonest, has a major impact on the soul condition because it affects the free will of other people.
Yeah.
Other people no longer make the choices they would have made mm-hmm. if they had been informed of the truth.
And so as our soul condition degrades, this impacts on even how our ability to love in a relationship or to give in a relationship, because we're worsening our condition, mm-hmm. our capacity to do those things is diminished.
Mm-hmm.
And so even just the very act of lying and that one corresponding effect has a huge detrimental
yes,
effect.
Yes, it's a terrible effect on yeah. our relationship, terrible effect on the other person, causes a large degree of mistrust in the relationship and suspicion in the relationship. Mm-hmm. And not only once it is exposed, but also in the future
yep.
as well, because now a person goes, well, last time they lied about this situation, it's probably highly likely they're going to lie again unless they've dealt with their issue mm-hmm. properly or appropriately. That's probably mm-hmm. what they're going to do.
Yeah.
Yep. So, yeah, it's very sad.
Yeah.
Very sad effects on the relationship.
So it also severely increases the chances of hurting a partner. Well, really, we are hurting our partner,
aren't we? Of
course
we're hurting them. Yep.
And then having to pay the penalty for the creation of that hurt within yes. the partner.
Yeah, so every little bit of creation of hurt that you create inside of your partner with regard to the lies that you've perpetrated towards your partner, whatever hurt they experience, you will have to pay the penalty for at some point in your future.
Mm-hmm.
Even if the relationship disbands, you'll still have to pay the penalty from God's perspective.
Yep.
So it has a severe effect on your own soul condition.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So dishonesty, the opposite is truthfulness, isn't it?
Of course.
This is the thing that binds people together.
Of course.
And so dishonesty is just the thing that's going to drive partners apart, isn't it?
Yes, and destroy completely, in most cases, relationships. Like once a person's been dishonest in a relationship, usually the relationship is destroyed pretty much there soon thereafter.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm.
It's sad to see it happen. You're far better off just saying the truth. If you don't want to be with your partner, tell your partner you don't want to be with them. If you want to have sex with another person, tell your partner you want to have sex with the other person before you go and do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you want to have a relationship with another person, tell your partner you're going to have a relationship with the other person and you're going to stop having a relationship with them.
Mm-hmm.
Be honest about it. It'll create hurt, but not as much hurt and particularly not as much hurt to yourself
mm-hmm.
as being untruthful does.
Yeah.
And in addition, you give them the ability to make choices and decisions then.
Yeah.
That they aren't able to make otherwise. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's much better to be completely open and honest with your partner, completely transparent on all matters,
yeah.
no matter what the result's going to be.
Yeah.
Yeah. For your life.
Yeah.
No matter what children you have, no matter who's going to think bad of you.
And often we think that the very act of telling the truth will mean the end of everything good.
Well, sometimes it does.
Sometimes it is, but sometimes it has a very
opposite effect.
Opposite effect on a relationship.
And I don't believe that anything is that's destroyed by telling the truth really existed in the first place. So, you know,
yeah.
you can't really destroy something that truly exists by telling the truth. You can only destroy, you know, something that didn't really exist.
Yeah. An illusion of something.
Yeah. Now, of course, if you are choosing, for example, if you're choosing to leave your partner for another person and you're being honest about it, you still might not be honest with yourself about it in mm-hmm. terms of what addictions are driving you to leave that partner for another person. And my suggestion is that you also be honest about that.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, you may repeat exactly the same relationship you've just had. So, you know, we need to be honest with both our future partner and the one that we're leaving and ourselves. Now, most people aren't in that situation, and most people are not honest with any of those themselves or their partner or their future partner, you know, if they're going to break up the relationship. But the key is to be honest with all, and that's why it's really good to have a break of time apart from these relationships so that you can be honest about what's really driving you under those circumstances.
Yeah.
And that requires a lot of personal desire to know oneself.
Yeah.
But it, obviously, if you don't know yourself, it's very, very hard to not present a facade to somebody else.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, it's why the personal emotional work is so crucial, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, great. Thank you.
Good. Well, that's another one down, another ruin to my relationship.
Another bad habit.
Another bad habit.
Yeah.
Running wild. Lost control.
How do addictions ruin my relationship?
Well, this is one of those qualities, again, that we probably need to look at the purpose of addictions before we can properly see how they would ruin our relationships.
Yeah.
The majority of people believe addictions help relationships, ironically, and that's because they don't understand the purpose of the addiction. If they fully understood the purpose of the addiction, they probably would be able to easily see that they're going to have a very strong bad effect on the relationship itself when the addiction's engaged.
So in this case, when you're saying that most people believe addictions are good for a relationship or even the basis of a relationship, you're meaning this this feeling that I have, like, I'm with you now, so you better help me avoid this and give me these feelings and I'm with...
I feel it's even more overt than that. It's like, you're a good person. I love you because you do these things for me.
Mm-hmm.
And you love me because I do these things for you.
Yep.
Right? And that's not love at all.
So the worth, really the worth of the partner is based upon their ability or their desire or their willingness to meet my addictions. That's how I measure your worth to me.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And as soon as I don't do that, what are you going to do?
Reject you.
Reject.
Yeah.
Straight away.
Yeah.
So addictions have a very strong potential to harm a relationship because of this.
Mm-hmm.
Most relationships have been established because of addiction.
Yeah.
Most of them have been established because I believe that a person who loves me will do this list of things that I've got in my mind and in my feelings, this list of things that they would do if they loved me.
Mm-hmm.
And I also believe that I would do a whole heap of things if I loved you. And you believe those things and we both accept those beliefs. And because we both accept those beliefs, we now feel attracted to each other. And in fact, there is an emotional attraction under those circumstances because we are both injured in what I would call sympathetic ways.
Yeah.
So in other words, I have an openness inside of me to believe that if a person finds me sexually attractive, it means that they love me.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean anything of the sort.
Yeah.
Right? They could be just using me. But if I have that injury, I will believe they love me as soon as they find me sexually attractive. So all I've got to do then is feel that you find me sexually attractive and I feel you love me.
Mm.
Right? Vice versa is also true. You know, the woman may feel that if the man makes her feel safe and secure financially, then he loves her, right?
Yeah.
Well, that's not true. And also, why does she need that? Like, she obviously is not able to create those things for herself somehow.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, she wouldn't need it. So really what is happening with addiction is that I have a whole heap of what I would classify as emotional holes within me. And you have a whole heap of emotional holes within you. And as long as I feel your holes and you feel my holes, our relationship is binding.
Yeah.
But as soon as one or both of us stop feeling these needs, this needy stuff that is in the other person, then the other person instantly angry, instantly feels I'm not being loved now, instantly feels like it's no longer a good relationship, right?
Yeah. So let's just clarify a couple of things that you said there. You said there is an actual connection, really, that's going on. There's an energetic exchange.
Emotional exchange.
Yep, emotional exchange.
Where our emotions are in sympathetic harmony.
And if we contrast this with some of the previous questions where we talked about the facade and untruthfulness, where we were talking about really interacting with something that's not coming from our soul. How does this relate to addictions? Are we now having a soul-based exchange based on addiction?
Well, the reality is most people are having an injured soul-based relationship based on all of the things we've mentioned so far.
Okay.
So that's the reality. If I've got an openness to being lied to and you want to lie to me, I'll accept your lies without question.
And that is a soul-based exchange.
That's a soul-based, injury-based exchange. Yep. It's not a love-based exchange.
No.
We're never going to be close. We're never going to be at one with each other in that exchange because it's not based on truth. It's also not based on humility or love.
Yep.
It's not based on honouring the free will. So at the end of the day, it's never going to be a close relationship, but we're going to believe it's close.
Yep.
Because I accept what you dish out and you accept what I dish out.
Yes.
Right? And every single one of these things we're mentioning today in this series, every single thing that can ruin a relationship usually begins with this codependency. So in other words, I want somebody to lie to me. And so I find someone who lies to me.
Yeah.
I want somebody to treat me like they're superior to me. So I find someone who treats me like that.
Yeah.
I want to find someone who's inferior so I can feel better about myself. So I find somebody who... And the law of attraction is working perfectly with regard to these relationships. What we're talking about here is how to get out of that and into a good relationship.
Yeah.
Because none of that is a good relationship, no matter how much we believe it is one.
Yeah.
Right. And this is where we find addictions particularly are, like, it's hard for the average person to go, if somebody's angry with me all the time, I feel good about it, right? The reality is, while there are attractions that occurred that caused the angry exchange and my acceptance of that anger, nobody feels good about it. But with addictions, that's different.
Yeah.
There is attractions that occur that make me believe that I feel good about it.
Mm-hmm.
Facade is very similar.
Yeah.
It makes me believe that I feel good about it. And as a result, these are harder things to give up in the relationship.
Yeah.
Because I believe they're good before I even look at them.
Yes.
Right? Of course, I'm in total denial and total unawareness of my true state.
Yeah.
But the reality is I believe it's good.
Mm-hmm.
And while I believe it's good, everything's good. I'm happy, seemingly.
Seemingly.
But I'm never going to be completely happy. I'm never going to have a close relationship with another soul in that state. And I'm never going to become at one with God in that state, ever.
Okay, so let's talk about why we want this so much. What is the purpose of living like this in this sort of addictive exchange all of the time?
Well, we could list hundreds and hundreds of reasons, couldn't we? And
we
don't want to go on for weeks having this exchange. So let's mention a few basic ones, I feel, as to why we would want to do it. And that would give us some ideas of what's going to happen when it doesn't get met.
Yeah. So living in addiction like this, it really helps me avoid my unloving demands and my unloving expectations. It helps me avoid feeling my fears.
So while I'm getting the addiction met.
Yep.
I'm avoiding the fact that I've got a whole heap of unloving crap coming out of me.
I don't even have to face
it. I don't even have to face it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because nobody around me is challenging it. Everyone's telling me I'm great.
Yeah.
No one's telling me, no, this is wrong.
Yeah.
Right? And I love it because nobody's telling me I'm wrong. I don't have to do anything. I just keep getting all of these unloving things done. Which, by the way, every unloving demand I have that gets satisfied degrades my soul further.
Mm-hmm.
I'll arrive in the hells of the spirit world guaranteed if I feed all of my addictions.
Yeah.
That's a sad fact.
And yet, as you mentioned, most of us call that love. When the other person meets all of my addictions, I love them so much.
Oh, so nice, yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
And yet they've just assisted you, your degradation into hell.
Yeah.
Basically, that's what they've done.
Yeah.
Which is the reason why we generally don't feed people's addictions.
Yes.
Because we don't want to assist you to arrive in hell when you pass.
Absolutely. Yeah. And why we strive so much to challenge any addiction that we might have.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. Addictions also, we mentioned, help us avoid feeling our fear, but also help us to avoid feeling even the feelings that are underneath our fear, our deep emotional pains.
Yes. Yes. So addictions help us cover over the true emotional state of ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
The problem with covering it over is that we don't experience it. If we don't experience it, we don't release it. If we don't release it, we can't grow. So, you know, obviously if we don't grow, our relationship can't grow.
Yeah.
So of course it's going to have a negative effect on our relationship.
The other reason we live in addiction is it creates a codependence that you've talked about, which makes us feel that everything's warm and fuzzy and wonderful in my life.
Yeah.
But within that, it's really forcing my partner to satisfy or take responsibility for or accept all of that unfelt pain and fear that we just mentioned.
Yes. So it's actually an imposition upon their will.
Mm-hmm.
They have to do what you want. And if they don't, you immediately will punish them.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's very, very negative. You're basically manipulating your partner.
Mm-hmm.
Now, codependent manipulation is usually acceptable by most people.
Yeah.
And I'm saying that no, any form of manipulation, codependent or not, is unacceptable if you're ever going to have a good relationship with another person.
Yeah.
And impossible to have a good relationship with God while you have it.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so addictions really help me to avoid being truly loving, truthful, and humble, which
yes.
is, as we talked about in the previous session, it's the whole basis for
of a good relationship.
A good relationship, yeah.
So addictions help me avoid all of the things that make a good relationship good.
Yeah,
that's pretty
and
full on.
I really use them in that way to help me avoid actually having to do those things.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it also causes me to be in this very frenzied state of unloving behaviour.
Yes, and it's the frenzied state that enables us to have our soul condition degrade. And it's the frenzied state where we do things that we don't even realise we're doing. That is a major problem with regard to addictions. Because we finish up going and doing things that eventually end up destroying our relationship without even thinking about them very much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you ask the average person who's cheated on their partner whether they thought much about it beforehand, the average person probably didn't, because there's a frenzied state being developed and they just go ahead and do it anyway without any thought of the repercussions upon their relationship. And it's often the case with just all of the things to do with addiction, even just the addiction of wanting your partner to take responsibility for, you know, your clothes or your food or your shelter or your money or whatever. All of these addictions are covering over severe imperfections within oneself.
Mm-hmm.
And as we've said and quite clearly stated in previous sessions on partner relationships, if we're ever going to have a good partner relationship, we need to work on becoming perfect ourselves. And if we're not going to do that, then obviously our relationship is impossible for our relationship to be perfect as well, if we're not going to become perfected ourselves. And my feeling is the average person accepts the imperfection and accepts the facade and the addictions, and because they believe that that is perfection.
Yeah.
You know, that it's such a lovely relationship being able to just have all of my needs and holes met. And it's so sad. It's like the statement, you complete me. Well, with two halves of the soul, that is strictly true.
Technically true,
but not emotionally true,
mm-hmm.
right? And I see a lot of people applying it emotionally and physically where they feel the other person completes them, when in fact all the other person is doing is meeting every one of their unhealed emotional addictions.
Yeah.
And both, unfortunately, in that relationship are unable to grow. The problem with codependent addictions, which are mostly what appear in relationships, is that it's impossible for both parties in the relationship to grow unless they both see their own codependencies and both see that their addictions are a sin
mm-hmm.
from God's sight, mm-hmm. but also their and sin in the sense of it'll cause their relationship to degrade, not to improve.
Yeah,
and they need to see that.
Yeah.
And yet, the majority of people on earth love these kind of relationships. They are like they are the kind of relationships where the average person believes they have the best relationship of all of their friends. And reality, what we observe is they have the most addictive relationship
mm-hmm.
compared to all of their friends,
mm-hmm.
the most codependently addictive relationship compared to all of their friends. So it's very, very sad to observe those kind of relationships. And the impact that those kind of relationships have on your relationship with God are severe
mm-hmm.
because you believe in your... You both agree with the addictive codependency. you do not feel there is a problem.
No.
And when you do not see there's a problem, you will never become at one with God. Because to become at one with God, you've got to begin to see your problems. You've got to see where your sin is preventing the flow of God's love into you. You've got to see where your choices and your will is being exercised out of harmony with receiving God's love. And if codependent addiction is one of the major ways that our choices are being exercised out of harmony with God's love. Yeah. We will not receive God's love while we are in codependent addiction with our partner.
Yeah.
So
very,
very destructive to your relationship with God.
Yeah. So let's talk about how it, you've talked a lot really about how it ruins a relationship.
Yes.
But let's just talk about some of the other key points.
Sure.
And perhaps you can explain how these things happen. So we've mentioned that addictions create codependence.
Yes.
And that's detrimental.
Yes. Detrimental because I'm giving you what you think you need, mm-hmm. which is out of harmony with love. Mm. And you're giving me what I think I need, which is out of harmony with love. Both of us are completely out of harmony with love, but we think it's love. We've got a hugely distorted view of love.
Yeah.
Right. And we'll never get close to God. We'll never experience at one with God and the bliss of that condition. And we're never going to ever be at one with each other either, because while there's injuries in the soul that are out of harmony with God, it's impossible for us to be out of harmony with God and at one with each other.
Mm-hmm.
So,
So, given that just about everyone feels that this codependence is love, and you're saying that that's completely out of harmony with love, this codependence, what does it look like then in a relationship where both parties want to love? What do they give each other?
Both parties give each other love, truth, their humility, mm-hmm. and their will. Mm-hmm. Like their will is combined to do everything. Both parties have a very developed will in the same direction when they're soulmates.
Mm-hmm.
And they're both giving to each other completely without the expectation the other person gives them anything.
So there's no expectation, and instead of assisting the suppression of emotion in the partner,
you're assisting the expression of emotion.
Got you.
All of it, including the hurt,
yep.
and the real self. The addiction does not encourage the hurt nor the real self to ever be expressed.
Yep.
So there's a huge amount of emotional suppression going on in a relationship that's full of addiction, mm-hmm. and yet seemingly happy.
Yeah.
Huge amount of emotional suppression.
Yeah.
Very, very damaging to the soul of the individual, and very damaging to your long-term health. And in fact, the main cause of most diseases in a relationship that occur in each body of the persons having the relationship. Cancers and everything are all very much defined. Mm-hmm. Some of the most serious and difficult diseases that we face on this planet are surrounding codependent addiction.
Okay.
People die from it.
Yeah.
Like there's a major cause of death.
Yeah.
Codependent addiction.
Yeah.
Major cause of death. Mm. People don't realize the relationship between their physical body's health and the unloving codependent addictions they remain in and desire to remain in.
Yeah.
Yeah. If people could see that it was the major cause of their physical death, they might start working through some of their issues with regard to addictions. It is a major sin from God's perspective, and it causes major suffering and pain and disease on this planet. So if you understood that, you would certainly act differently.
So can we talk about then the way that addictions actually create more pain or intense pain within a relationship? How does that happen?
Well, if we're in codependent addiction, the feeling is the more I give you what you need and the more you give me what we need, the closer we are, right? That's mm-hmm. the codependent addiction.
Yeah.
The problem, though, is to do that, our body and our spirit body must give things that the body's not designed to give. And the body must receive things that it's not designed to receive as feelings and emotions that are out of harmony with love. The more disharmony there is in love of emotions that are flowing through my body and yours, the more potential there is for disease.
Mm-hmm.
So that's first. Our physical suffering is mostly caused by this codependent addiction that's occurring in the relationship. Mm-hmm. So that's number one.
Mm-hmm.
Now, most relationships finish up, particularly if they're long-term relationships, finish up having one or both parties with severe health problems as a result.
Yeah.
So there's the first, pain and suffering.
Yeah.
The second pain and suffering is that what occurs after our passing. Mm-hmm. The intense negative condition that we're now in because of our unloving conditions and demands means that we arrive in the spirit world in a hellish condition, with surrounded by people who have exactly the same demands that we have.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I've seen many people stay in that condition for thousands of years, in that hellish suffering condition, not willing to get out of it because of still wanting their codependent addictions met. Right, not ever getting them met, but wanting them met. Right, yep. Many people therefore attach themselves to other people on earth after they've passed to have these addictions met, which causes further pain and suffering to the people on earth and to their own selves, mm-hmm. and completely degrades their condition even more. It is the major reason why the hells exist on this planet, you know, surrounding the planet.
Yeah,
and so it has a terrible effect on the soul of the individuals involved. It also has a very, very damaging effect on your children. The children grow up to believe what you're demonstrating is what love is. And so they themselves enter the same kind of bartering relationship, believing it to be love. And they therefore have the same result imposed upon them as what you have imposed upon you.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Then you've got what happens when your addictions are not met inside of the relationship on earth.
Because it's very difficult, isn't it, to continually meet
another person's constant demands.
Yep.
Yeah, very hard.
Mm-hmm.
And so sooner or later, one or both of you start getting angry about this. Then, of course, you have all the results of the anger and rage being expressed towards each half, which causes a lot of emotional turmoil and distress, as well as a lot of physical pain that intensifies because of the growing negative emotional condition inside of oneself.
Yeah.
Not only that, because we are working in our addictions, we are completely emotionally insensitive. We are unable to feel what's going on in our environment. We're unable to protect ourselves. We're less secure. We're less safe. We're more destructive personally to ourselves, and also more destructive to other people as a result. And every destruction we create causes more negative condition in our soul.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a terrible thing that occurs, unfortunately. And if people could realize the extent of the damage that is caused through codependent addiction, they would never wish to engage it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And this is one of the reasons why we are so hot on it when in our discussions with people.
Yeah.
Because if they realize that it is the main reason why the hells exist, because people who live in this codependent addiction need the hells to get out of a place that's so unloving by the time they arrive there. They need the hells to exist so that they can live somewhere. That's how bad it is.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's a terrible, terrible state to get into. And we can't say enough about trying to get out of it.
Yeah, and it's also so insidious, isn't it? Because very often people call it happiness or love or contentment.
When we observe it.
Yeah.
They're just saying, oh, we've got such a happy relationship, and we see all these codependent addictions destroying their soul, and they're all just going merrily on their way to self-destruction.
Yeah.
And it's just a sad thing to observe. And when you're a spirit in the spirit world observing millions and billions of people doing this,
mm-hmm.
it's just like a major cause of humanity's suffering.
Yeah.
And major cause, like I said, of humanity's pain, physical pain,
yeah.
disease, and all those kinds of things that are caused through these codependent addictions by us believing that something is good when it actually is very bad, very unloving.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the problem is. We believe it to be good, which causes us to engage the behavior, causing our self-destruction.
Okay, well, I mean, I think you've spoken passionately about that.
Yep.
We've brought up really that it's addictions are manipulative and controlling of ourselves and our partner. So
yes.
we're kind of controlled by this compulsion. We're also attempting to manipulate our partner into meeting these things.
Of course.
Yeah.
So we want them, we're trying to overcome their will to not meet these things.
Yeah.
And we want them to meet these things in order for us to be happy, and therefore us to not punish them as well. We We do it because, you know, we want them to meet our addictions. If they don't meet our addictions, what do? We generally punish them.
Yeah.
That's not a love relationship.
Yeah.
What's that? That's like an autocratic, like, dictator relationship.
Yeah.
Right? And unfortunately, we even do it to each other on different issues.
Yeah.
Terrible.
Yeah. Okay. We actually replace any love exchange with a barter system.
Yes, bartering systems, not love.
No.
You know, stop thinking that a bartering system, whether it's financial or you know, relationship-based, emotional-based, is love, because it's not.
Yeah. Yep. So our relationship can't really go anywhere because there's nothing really going on in terms of
love. It's all dependent on me doing for you what you want and you doing for me what I want.
Yeah.
It's not. There's no love that forms the foundation of the relationship. As soon as a little bit of stress comes on the relationship, it's highly unlikely this relationship will survive.
Yeah.
Right? It only is surviving through codependent addiction.
Yeah.
As soon as a bit of stress forms, like, love isn't binding it.
No.
I'm not wanting to give the gift of my love to you, and you're not wanting to give the gift of your love to me without expectation in return. And while that's happening, like, we haven't got a love-based relationship at all. We've got a contract. We might as well have gone out. That's the purpose of marriage, isn't it? Go out and get the piece of paper that says you're going to do a whole heap of things for me and I'll do a whole heap of things for you, and we'll be happy as a result, right? Definitely won't occur.
No, it won't occur, because as happens over time, eventually these things start to feel very oppressive.
Of course.
If I've got the demands on you, you do what I want. Eventually, even if you're willing to do those things, I start to feel oppressed by what you want me to do.
Of course. And also it's an insatiable.
Yeah.
Because the whole exists within yourself emotionally. It's an insatiable demand. Mm. The other person can never do enough.
No, because it's never the way to effectively remove that hole, which is really a painful emotion, isn't it?
That needs to be experienced, yes. Yeah. Yes.
And because the addictions are continually, we're using them to avoid these painful emotions, we can never really have emotional or sexual intimacy, can we?
No. Any sexual contact we have is based on our addictions.
Mm.
It's just me feeding your addictions, you're feeding mine. So if the addiction happens to be one of power, then I'll be submissive and you'll have power, or vice versa.
Yeah.
If the addiction, this is sexually, you know, if the addiction is one of control, then you'll have control or I'll have control and you won't.
Yeah.
If the addiction is one of, you know, making the other person feel inferior to you, then I'll be the person who's superior in sexually, you'll be the inferior one. You know, it's just like... It's impossible to have an equal relationship and an equal sexual relationship that's strong without there being, you know, when there is all these addictions in play. So I see many people go, they say, oh, we have a wonderful sex life. And their sex life is terrible because one of them is angry and bitter and twisted, and the other one just satisfies the anger, bitterness of the person and does it sexually. And because of that, they're both happy.
Yeah.
But it's not happy.
Yeah.
Like, it's destroying their soul. They're going to end up in such a bad condition when they arrive in the spirit world that they're just going to wonder what caused them to be there. And they won't even know, because they'll believe that they did everything right and it was such a good relationship.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's so delusional, this state of addiction.
Yeah.
Just like any person who has a physical addiction is in a state of delusion. A person who's drinking too much is in a state of delusion about his life. The same goes with a drug addict. And the same goes with people who are emotionally addicted.
Mm.
They're in a state of delusion about their entire life and their own condition.
Mm. And because addictions are there to help suppress these emotions, and it's only through the experiencing of emotions that actual intimacy occurs, actual closeness sexually or emotionally occurs. While we're living in these addictions in our relationships all the time, we can never be close, because the emotions aren't flowing.
No.
Yeah.
There's no hope of intimacy emotionally or sexually, right? And I mean real soul-to-soul sexual intimacy and real soul-to-soul emotional intimacy. It's just going through the filters of our needy, frenzied addictions.
Yeah.
That's all it's going through.
And real sexual intimacy is only ever a reflection of emotional intimacy that already exists in a relationship, doesn't it?
Yeah. And this is why there's huge amounts of sexual problems on the planet as well, of course, because these emotional addictions exist, which cause the sexual problems to be expressed.
It's basically reflecting, isn't it? The sexual aspect of the relationship is always perfectly reflecting the true
emotional state of the relationship.
So as you mentioned earlier, if there's a very dominating person and in the relationship and a very submissive person, and they're willing to meet each other in codependent addiction around that, they might have a lot of sex, but it won't be truly intimate sexual encounters.
No, they'll think it's wonderful because they're meeting each other's addictions. But the reality, they've just destroyed each other's condition as well.
Yeah.
You know, from God's perspective, if they could see their condition being destroyed, they would probably stop the process. Although there's plenty of spirits in the spirit world who can see their own condition being destroyed and still don't stop the process. Mm. So it's the frenzy of addiction that causes you to think that things are good when actually they're very bad for you. Mm. You know, it's just like the addict, the drug addict, or the addict towards drink, the alcohol, believing that those substances are good for them, mm-hmm. you know, that they're necessary for their life. It's a self-delusional state.
Yeah.
Yeah. But happily engaged by the individual, seemingly happily engaged. Yeah. Of course, they're never happy because it's never satisfied.
Mm-mm. So if there's one way to seriously improve your relationship, it's to not enter addictions or to
And to actively help and assist each other to address them.
Yeah.
Do the exact opposite. Instead of actively helping each other and assisting each other to remain in them, actively help each other and assist each other to see them, become aware of them, stop being in denial of them, address them honestly, truthfully, you know, with God's help, you'll work through these issues. But the reality is, if you don't do that, your relationship's in serious trouble and your own condition is in serious trouble too. Mm-hmm. Your own soul condition mm-hmm. is in serious trouble.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we need to see it for the serious thing it is. And I feel that this is something that, you know, we've talked about addictions over and over again in the past, and the majority of people still do not see how seriously evil they are. Mm. They just think they're innocent even. Oh, it's just sad.
It is.
Because it's like, you know, it is the thing that caused the hells in the first place. Like, and it's the thing that causes most people from this world to end up in the hells after they pass. Mm-hmm. Sad.
Yeah.
So that's why, you know, you'd be far better off in the relationship confronting addiction. Every day working through addiction, every day working through what, you know, what am I doing here? What am I doing there? So you will grow in love greatly if you just harness working the ability to work through your addictions rather than living in codependent addictions.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm. Okay. Excellent.
Okay. Big ruin for our relationship.
It is.
Bad habits. Can't help myself. And that one's running wild.
Yeah. Yeah. How does avoiding my emotional experience ruin my relationship?
Yes, again, this one is a difficult one for most people to face because they have a tendency to believe that their emotions are what cause problems in their relationship rather than their emotions being the cause of problems.
The avoiding
emotions being the cause of problems in their relationship. So what we really need to do firstly is define carefully what we mean by avoiding the emotions. What we're not talking about avoiding emotions such as anger or other things like that. Yeah. What we're talking about is avoiding the real emotional feeling we have within us at any point in time. In other words, what is the truthful emotional condition of myself as an individual? When I avoid that truthful emotional condition as an individual, and avoid feeling it, expressing it, then I'm causing a major breakdown in my relationship with myself and also in my relationship with my partner.
Yeah.
So now, why would I do it? Well, I do it because I have to, because I believe I have to maintain certain conditions.
Mm-hmm.
I'm afraid of certain emotions like shame and guilt, and I don't want to be crying all day, and I have certain judgments of emotion, and there's a whole slew of reasons, and we won't go into all of them here, as to why I may choose to suppress myself emotionally or suppress my partner emotionally.
Yeah.
But either one of those two things that I choose to do will cause a major degradation in my relationship. My relationship won't have the potential of growing.
Mm.
Because it's only by releasing these unhealed emotional parts of myself, or releasing the healed parts of myself and expressing them. In other words, mm-hmm. if I have a desire, truly expressing it as mm-hmm. it really is, rather than suppressing it, that I'll actually be myself.
Yeah.
And when I'm myself, I'll now have the ability to present myself as a gift to my partner.
Yeah.
And isn't that the forming the basis of my relationship? Part of my relationship is not only presenting the gift of my love to my partner,
mm-hmm.
but also giving the gift of who I am truly,
yeah.
not facade, not injuries, but who I am truly to my partner.
Yeah.
Right. Now, obviously, to give myself as I am truly to my partner, I have to work through my facade and work through my injuries in order to get to my real self to present that.
Yep.
And so that means I'm going to have to be open to experiencing all sorts of emotion.
Mm.
So if I shut down the experience of all sorts of emotion, myself to of my own,
mm-hmm.
then myself I am never going to be. I'm only going to be a fiction
mm-hmm.
that I present to my partner. So I'm never presenting myself to my partner. If I expect my partner to do the same, I'm actually wanting my partner to not present herself to me,
yeah.
but present a fiction of herself to me.
Yeah.
Now, that's obviously never going to result in a very truly binding, long-term, everlasting relationship.
Yeah.
So the ability to feel and experience emotion in a loving way is a key part of growing your relationship
mm.
with anybody, mm-hmm. but in particular with your partner and God.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Yeah. Okay, so the reasons we might do it.
Yes, let's look at them.
You've already mentioned I might avoid my emotional experience because it helps me maintain this fictional condition.
Yes.
To myself and to my partner, and I might actually want that.
Yes. So I've got to give up the desire for it, but I want it for some reason. And usually the reason is because I don't want to experience the pain.
Pain. Yep. 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 Okay. It also helps me make my partner responsible for that painful emotion, doesn't it?
Of course it does.
Yep.
Any pain that I have within me that I expect to live with, I'm also expecting you to live with mm-hmm. it too.
And if I don't want to feel it, then I'm definitely like you to take responsibility for it. So it's even off my plate. Yeah.
Well, I'm even wanting you to meet my addictions about it too.
Yeah.
So that's what creates my addictions. If I refuse to feel my true emotional condition, addictions are automatically created.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
So it's a major reason why I've created addiction.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we've talked about addiction in a previous question about how destructive it is to our soul condition,
yeah.
and therefore destructive to our relationship. Yeah. But this is what we do.
Yeah.
And we do it because we're trying to avoid being emotionally overwhelmed about all sorts of issues and matters that we need to feel about and we refuse to feel about.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. And on the other hand, when I'm trying to avoid my partner's emotional experience, I'm trying to maintain a fiction. I don't want to be sensitive to his personal pain.
Yes, I don't want to feel what he really feels.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I put to the audience that if I don't want to feel what you really feel and you don't want to feel what I really feel,
mm-hmm.
then what kind of a relationship are we having? It's not much of a relationship.
It's not.
Is it? Like, so we're just fooling ourselves if we're having a relationship thinking that I don't want to feel what he feels and she doesn't want to feel what I feel. And
yeah.
and what's going to end up there? Only emotional distance. Mm. It's the only possibility.
Yep.
Yep.
Yep. And so there's distance. And then I'd like to just ask you to clarify this issue of taking responsibility for each other's pain.
Yes.
Because basically, if I'm shutting down your emotional experience, I'm going to wind up taking responsibility for your pain. through the workings of our relationship? Is that how it works?
Well, it'll work on both ends. If I shut down my emotional experience, I'm forcing you to take responsibility for my emotional experience, in that you have to compensate. In order for us to have a relationship, you will have to compensate for the things that I'm unwilling to address inside of myself.
Yeah.
Now, that's a very selfish thing to do.
It is.
Very selfish. And if obviously you did that to me, I wouldn't be happy. So why would I do that to you? It's not ethical to do that in the relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, ethics don't seem to have much of a part in most relationships, but they should do.
Yeah.
And if I was ethical, I would never want you to pay a penalty of any kind, physical, emotional, spiritual, of any kind, sexual, for my choice to remain in my injury.
Yeah.
And yet that's what I'm forcing you to do by living with you while I'm hoping to suppress my emotional condition.
Mm.
I'm forcing you to do that.
So in a very concrete way, if I don't want to feel my fear and I want you to be in a relationship with me, I'm going to expect you to make concessions for me in our life whenever my fear might be triggered and I want to do something other than feel it, take a different action or change our life or even behave in a certain way that helps me avoid my fear. I'm expecting you to accept it.
Yes.
And to modify
and
yourself
accordingly. And to compensate for it.
Yeah.
Very selfish behavior.
Yeah.
Yeah. So when you choose to not take personal responsibility for your emotion, you are being very selfish because you are now imposing those emotions on other people, and they have to, in order to maintain a relationship with you, accept your imposition.
Yep.
The only way that they can't is to leave you, which of course would cause you further problems, right? And obviously cause them distress too, potentially, because they, if they love you, they won't want to leave you.
Mm-hmm.
They want to be with you, right?
Mm-hmm.
But there are times if we truly love a person, you're going to have to leave them while if they have these demands.
Yeah.
If they have the demand to shut down emotionally for myself, if I have the demand to shut down emotionally for myself, I am harming you because I am forcing you. I am forcing your will to either leave. You've either got to leave or you've got to stay and do what my emotional shutdown demands. That's the only choices available to you to have a relationship. It's the only choice I'm giving you to have a relationship with me.
Yeah.
It's terrible.
Yeah.
If I shut down your emotions, so now I'm talking about my personal desire to shut down your emotions, I am purposefully trying to stop you from progressing. I'm personally trying to stop you from ever being happy. I'm personally trying to stop you from ever enjoying your life. Now, how cruel can I be?
Yeah.
By shutting you down emotionally, I am trying to stop you from a whole heap of wonderful things that are your potential if I wasn't in your life.
Yeah.
And yet I'm there saying, I want to be in your life, but I'm going to shut you down.
Yeah.
I want to be in your life, but I'm going to force you. Because I don't want to cope with this stuff coming out of you, right? It's very selfish behavior.
It is. And yet it's so, so, so very common, isn't it?
Oh, of course. It's very common.
A woman starts crying and her husband says, oh, please don't cry. You don't need to cry. Come on, I'll cheer you up and you know,
terrible
make you feel
behavior.
Better. Yeah. And yet most people see that as him being a good guy.
Well, most women even see that as him being a good guy.
Yeah.
But it's actually terrible for their relationship. Mm-hmm. It's causing her to not be able to release something that she needs to release. She needs to release it. You need to help her release it.
Yeah.
Having compassion will certainly help her release it.
Yeah.
But telling her to shut down won't help her release it. It'll close her down. Yeah. The opposite of release.
Yes. And women do it very routinely with men when it comes to anger or grief.
Yes.
Most
women are extremely terrified when their men cry.
Yeah.
Just terrified.
Yeah.
Because they want the men to be strong and look after all the stuff that's happening that they're terrified of.
Yeah.
And when the man's crying and feeling vulnerable, they themselves start to feel vulnerable and weak.
Mm-hmm.
And they themselves start to become very, very afraid.
Yeah.
And when they become very afraid, they start to close him down, try to shut him down, try to even imply that he's being weak now, stupid or whatever. And now they're being very selfish, of course, but they're also now imposing their desire upon him to shut down. Now, to remain in an open state, he has to leave.
Yeah.
There's no choice. He can't stay in his relationship that he wants and be open.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the choice he's being given. And it's a terrible thing to do to your partner to do that.
Absolutely.
We've seen it happen so many times.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's a terrible thing to do.
Yeah.
And it is much worse than even most people believe. And even the receiving partner on the receiving end believes it's the good thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's not. Your beliefs of love are so severely distorted that you believe that someone shutting you down is a good thing.
Yeah.
Like, that's how distorted your belief of love is. If you believe it's a good thing, you are severely damaged with love, and you need to get God's perspective of love if you're ever going to have a good relationship.
Yeah. And I love that you're stressing it so much, because it is so, so, so common. And people engineer their entire lives around avoiding their emotional experience or managing their partner's emotional experience.
Yeah.
And it takes so much time and effort. It's so detrimental to the relationship.
Yep.
And
very detrimental to your future.
Yeah.
To your soul condition, it is very destructive, because every new injury that is added to your condition has no form of release.
That's right.
There is no chance of it being released.
Yeah.
So all that can happen is that your condition will degrade.
Yeah.
There's no release, so your condition can't improve. The only way your condition improves is by release.
Yeah.
So you're consigning yourself to a continual degradation of your condition. Now, over 70 or 80 years, the average person has a whole thousands of events to release.
Yep.
None of them being released means that they are all going to have to be released at some point in their future life in the spirit world.
Yeah.
Right? And there's a subsequent pain and suffering of what they choose to do out of harmony with love by not releasing them.
Yeah.
Because it's only our unhealed emotional condition that causes us to go and do something even worse.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then, of course, we've got the penalties of that on our soul. And this is why the majority of people who are on emotional shutdown end up in the hells of the spirit world.
Yeah.
They do.
Yeah. 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 Yes. Okay. Well, I think you've told us how it ruins a relationship.
Yeah, pretty plain,
I think. We've made a couple of notes extra to that. And perhaps I'll say everything we've written here, because some of it you've already mentioned, and it doesn't hurt repeating it. Okay. Avoiding personal emotional responsibility creates more painful experiences, since the law of attraction attempts to force the release of painful emotions.
Yes.
So we have the pain within us. The law of attraction is going to keep coming at us to help us
in
release
in stronger
that.
And stronger doses.
Yeah.
To help us release that pain. You know, the average person believes completely the opposite of that. They believe that by suppressing their emotion, they are controlling their painful experiences.
Yeah.
But what they're actually doing is increasing them.
Yeah.
That's sad.
That's such an important
point. It's actually doing the opposite of what you think.
Yeah. And then, so the law of attraction comes, there's more painful events to try and help trigger this causal pain.
Yep.
And then we suppress more, we use more addictions, which creates more pain.
More badness.
And more attractions
are needed. And now we're creating evil.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right.
So it's not just that we're avoiding our personal emotion anymore. Now we're actually creating evil in the world.
Yeah.
Very bad for us.
Yes.
Very bad for us.
And hopefully this is incentive for everyone at home to, you know, really start to look sincerely at
the importance of these particular principles. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Avoiding personal emotional responsibility creates an imaginary state within the relationship.
Of course. Yeah. That's pretty plain.
We've kind of looked at that.
Yeah. Yep. It's pretty clear that if I'm faking my emotions and you're faking yours, that we've pretty much got a fake relationship.
And if I'm just trying to suppress yours and suppress mine,
then we've both got a suppressed relationship.
There's no, as we said in a previous question, the flow of emotion is what enables intimacy.
Yeah.
If there's no flowing of emotion, there's no...
No passion, no desire. Yeah. This is why people end up just cohabiting without passion, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Mm. Okay, avoiding personal emotional responsibility creates an emotional bartering system.
Yes. I'll do for you what I don't want to do for myself. You do for me what you don't want to do for yourself. So I've now created evil.
Yeah.
I've now chosen to barter, which is now creating addiction, which is now creating evil. I'm choosing to harm you. I'm choosing to harm your will. I'm choosing to not be loving to you. There's a whole heap of things I'm choosing by making that choice.
Yeah.
And as soon as I do all of those things, my condition degrades. My condition degrades, our condition degrades. Mm-hmm. Our relationship degrades.
Mm-hmm.
Sooner or later, it's going to be destructive to the relationship.
To the relationship, yeah. Okay. Avoiding personal emotional responsibility causes the relationship to stagnate, which you've just really mentioned.
Yes, there's a difference between degradation and stagnation. Mm-hmm. And we've talked about the degradation, but the stagnation is, I'm happy just to do for you what you want. You're happy to do for me what I want. We're generally loving people. We don't try to destroy other people's lives or destroy each other or any of those kind of things. We get along quite well. We're not always attacking other people. And under those circumstances, our condition will remain stagnant in the hells.
Yeah.
We might not be in the depths of the hells because we're not have engaged a whole heap of more unloving behaviour, but we'll still be in the first sphere of the spirit world, unable to progress until we get out of the codependent addiction.
Yeah, and I can think of a number of couples like this who feel they're very pleasant with people around them. They've got enough means so that they're comfortable financially, not a huge...
They don't have a large amount of addictions being triggered into anger.
Yeah, that's right. But the addictions with their partner, that's their primary relationship, the person they spend the most time with. Some of them are even retired.
Yeah.
They have this pleasant enough lifestyle where they do things that they find enjoyable. They rarely argue. They feel they behave pleasantly towards each other and towards other people.
Yeah.
But underlying it all are some very key codependencies. And this is where the couple is just probably going to stay pretty stagnant. But gradually, there's a degradation.
They'll probably stay stagnant or degrade just slightly their entire life. One or two, both of them will get diseases or die, Of course, they'll both die eventually because of old age, because that's what happens when you're in codependent addiction as well.
Yeah.
So they'll both die. They'll both arrive in the spirit world, probably stay together for a bit longer in the spirit world.
Yeah.
Both of them will not have a relationship with God.
Yeah.
Because the codependency prevents a relationship with God. Once they realise that they want a relationship with God, then they'll probably start growing.
Yeah.
Or they'll start seeing the possibilities, in their first sphere condition, they'll have people visit them and go, look, you can be in a second sphere condition if you deal with this. And then they'll realise that it's their own condition that causes them or prevents them from being in a better place.
Yeah.
And under those circumstances, the selfishness of that will possibly motivate them to start addressing some of these emotions.
Mm.
But those kind of people, indolent people, generally stay a long time in spheres of the spirit world. Very rarely do they grow very rapidly. They might stay 200 years in the first sphere and 100 years in the second sphere and 500 years in the third sphere and 1,000 years in the fourth sphere. And they might still be in the fourth sphere after 7,000 years because they're just enjoying where they're at rather than having a desire to grow.
Yeah.
And it's a sad thing I observe because these kind of people, it's very hard to motivate them to growth.
Mm-hmm. I do notice that in couples who they both might have a keen, or so-called keen interest in divine truth here on earth, but because their day-to-day life is so comfortable, what they would call comfortable, we watch them over 5-6 years, they find it that they're not
that
motivated.
We haven't seen them make a single change in that time. Not a single one.
Yeah.
Or if they have, it's very, very slow.
Yeah.
Very slow. And
so there's not a lot of incentive with current discomfort.
Not only that, they haven't begun their development of their relationship with God, because if they had have, they would probably feel more of a stronger motivation to develop that relationship than they currently have.
So for couples like that, would you say that what would be their next step? To feel more sensitive to them, to the truth of what's happening?
The trouble is they are internally in a state of semi-pleasure of their own condition and not seeing the truth. But there's little you can do to help them until they personally can see that there is a potential of being happier.
Yeah.
You see, for a lot of people, it's only the unhappiness that drives change.
That's right.
And as soon as they become happy, they no longer change.
Yeah.
Right? What I'm suggesting is that bliss and happiness is a thing that can continue to grow forever.
Mm-hmm.
So once you have understand in your soul and in your mind that actually, while you may believe yourself to be happy right now, there is a lot brighter and stronger places of happiness than where you currently exist. And once you really believe that, then you may try to approach those places mm-hmm. by working through the things that prevent you from being there.
Yeah.
So for people who are sort of what I would classify as relatively happy, it's the relative happiness that often causes them to remain stagnant.
Mm-hmm.
And stagnation in itself is not growth. It is and you've got to ask yourself, well, if you have the potential to be blissfully happy, but you're only sort of happy, surely the potential of being blissfully happy is worth striving for.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, there's a lot of people who get into this indolent state on earth and just feel that once they have a level of, and fear as mm-hmm. well drives that state, you know, because they're afraid of losing that state.
Yeah.
But once they get to a level of, you know, where they're semi-happy or relatively happy or mostly happy mm-hmm. or what they believe is mostly happy in comparison to what happened in their past,
yeah.
Then a lot of people stop striving.
Yeah.
And when you stop striving or seeking, more truth can't come to you and therefore more bliss and happiness can't receive it.
Mm.
Now, you know, what can you do about that? Well, you need to realize that there is more bliss than you can possibly conceive of that God is offering you.
Mm-hmm.
And it only requires you working through some things. That's all it requires, not much.
Mm.
And in fact, once you've worked through the few things that are blocking you receiving God's love, it only requires that you receive more of God's love, which is not a trauma at all. Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful thing to experience. So surely you should attempt to try it,
mm.
even if you believe yourself to be relatively happy right now.
Yeah,
stagnation emotionally is a problem because it causes people to believe they're relatively happy and unfortunately causes them to remain in a stagnant condition, whether that condition be good or bad, good in comparison to the average person on earth or bad, it doesn't really matter. What matters is, are you prepared to grow for the rest of your existence? Because if you are, you can experience the supreme happiness that comes from growth for the rest of your existence. But if you're willing to stay in stagnant conditions for long periods of time, then obviously you're never going to experience in the next few years the blissful conditions.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be thousands of years or tens of thousands of years or hundreds of thousands of years before you do.
Yeah.
And my suggestion to you is, well, why put off something for 100,000 years that you could have in 10 years?
Yeah.
Like, it makes no sense. But I can understand the reason why people choose to do it when they're afraid.
Yeah.
You know, and when I say understand, I still don't agree with it.
Yeah.
Because it makes no sense emotionally to live in a condition of semi or relative happiness when absolute bliss is your future.
Okay. Back to avoiding personal responsibility.
These are all the results of avoiding them.
Yes. Yeah. Another result is that it causes unconscious, unloving behaviour driven by our unfelt emotions.
Yes. When I say unconscious or unfelt, what I'm talking about is that because we're suppressing our emotions, we are not aware of the emotion that drives our unloving behaviour. And so what happens is the emotion still drives our unloving behaviour. We're just not aware of the cause of what's being driven. So we act out unloving behaviour and don't know what the cause is and don't understand why we're doing it.
Yeah.
Right? We're doing it because we're suppressing the awareness emotionally.
Yeah.
The reality is there's no real thing as unconscious behaviour,
mm-hmm.
right? There's no real thing as subconscious either. What it is this state where we're unwilling to be aware, right? And it requires a development of our will to become aware.
Yeah.
And once we develop our will to become aware, we will be aware of what we're doing.
Yeah.
And then we can choose differently. Before then, we'll be unaware of the cause and we'll do whatever the cause suggests.
Yeah.
And if the cause suggests, well, you know, let me sit here reading the paper while my wife, you know, prepares every meal for me.
Mm-hmm.
If that's what the cause suggests, that's what I'll do.
Yeah.
But it is unloving behaviour.
Yeah.
That's why sooner or later our wife's probably going to be upset with us about it.
Yeah. Okay. Avoiding personal emotional responsibility causes too many problems to list in this discussion.
Exactly. Yeah, it does. I was there listening this thing for this session and going, my goodness, we could go on for months and months about this, about what it causes. And also what it stops you from enjoying as well. It doesn't only cause a whole heap of negative effects. It also stops you from enjoying a whole heap of positive things. Yeah. Like it has this double whammy, as the saying goes, you know, on our life and on our relationship.
Yeah. Right? Well, even just when you've talked about this in the principles of how the human soul works, if we're suppressing our painful emotions, our pleasurable emotions are also suppressed.
Correct.
And our capacity to experience pleasure is diminished.
Yeah. So what we're doing, by suppressing our emotion, we're also suppressing our sexual enjoyment. We're suppressing our happiness, the bliss of our happiness. You know, it'll be this much instead of this much.
Yeah.
Our sexual enjoyment will be this much instead of this much.
Yeah.
Everything will be this much instead of this much.
Yeah.
Because we're suppressing the emotion to this much.
Mm-hmm.
And the negative effect of our life is we don't get to experience ourselves as we truly are. We don't get to enjoy ourselves as we're created to be. We don't ever get to grow to what God created us to be. Because that's very intensely about our emotional growth, our ability to receive more and more powerful feelings from God is what will cause us to emotionally expand. And so if we're unable to do that, if we're consigning or controlling our emotional expression to a certain level, then of course we are unable to experience the bliss of these other conditions. So it has a negative effect on us, and also it also destroys a positive effect as well.
Yeah.
And so we really can't say enough about emotional expression and its importance in our day-to-day life. And the ability to be sensitive to our emotions is something you desperately want to encourage within one in yourself and in your partner. Rather than destroy. And if you do that, you'll have a very good relationship. But if you don't, well, you've got some very bad habits to break there, because it is a worldwide bad habit, this one.
Yeah.
Emotional suppression inside of relationships are a very strong motivation on both parties, usually in relationships, and it's very destructive to having a great relationship.
Absolutely.
You know?
The truth. All right.
Another one, bad habit down.
Right. How does living in emotional hurt ruin my relationship?
Well, this is when we talk about living in emotional hurt, what we're talking about is living in the unfelt hurt of our childhood rather than experiencing and releasing the unfelt hurt so it no longer controls us. The problem with living in the hurt or keeping the hurt within oneself is that it defines all of our belief systems.
Yeah.
It controls what we believe.
Mm-hmm.
It affects our pessimism about life, and it affects every decision and choice we make.
It really affects how we see reality, doesn't it?
It does. We perceive things to be real that God knows are completely unreal, and we perceive things to be unreal that God knows are completely real.
Mm-hmm.
So it has a terrible effect on our life if we do this. And I suppose, again, we need to go through what are the, you know, why we do it.
Yep. Okay. Well, it causes me to justify to myself unloving, untruthful and arrogant behaviour with my partner.
Yes.
So if I want those things, I'm going to want to live in my hurt, aren't I?
Yes. A person who's living in their hurt basically justifies their hurt to the world.
Yep.
So what they do is they're basically saying to the world, I had this hurt when I was a child, and everyone around me now needs to make it go away, and everybody now needs to know that I've had it, and everybody needs to know how bad it was, and everybody has to feel how bad it was with me, and everybody, you know, and we've got this long list of demands that we're basically making to everybody in the world.
Yeah.
And of course, our partner, being our closest companion, is the person who's receiving most of them most of the time, unfortunately.
Yeah. Okay. Living in emotional hurt causes me to unfairly blame my partner for my own emotional hurt.
Yes. When I live in my emotional hurt, I almost believe that my partner has caused it.
Mm-hmm.
Even though intellectually I possibly know that my childhood has caused it.
Yeah.
I almost believe that my partner should make it go away. Mm-hmm. And therefore I'm basically blaming my partner for its cause.
And also, isn't there the issue where I might be having an interaction with my partner who something in that interaction triggers some of that hurt and I'm living in that hurt, blaming everyone else for it?
Well, can I point out that any truthful belief will trigger the hurt? Because
mm-hmm.
every one of the emotions and beliefs of the hurt self is actually false.
Yeah.
They're actually false beliefs.
Yeah.
They're actually unloving beliefs.
Yeah.
So any truthful statement by my partner,
mm-hmm.
any acceptance of God's truth and God's love by my partner will cause me to believe that my partner's being unloving to me.
So I'm going to blame them.
And I'm going to blame him for it.
For exposing, just for being the way that they are, for
well,
being
no,
truthful.
No, I'm actually blaming him for disagreeing with me. I want my partner, whoever that is, to agree that my hurt was real and my hurt was matters and my hurt this and my hurt, and very selfish it is.
Yeah.
And when my partner says, well, this is not how is it God from God's perspective, I will get intensely rageful with mm-hmm. him or her
mm-hmm.
about them making those kind of statements.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this is very destructive for my relationship because it's going to trigger a whole heap of addictions, unloving behavior, a whole heap of evil behavior in the end
yeah.
towards my partner if I remain in this hurt.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Living in my emotional hurt places the demand upon my partner to ignore my emotional injuries and to satisfy my emotional demands.
Correct.
Yeah.
So this is where I'm starting to create evil now.
Yeah.
I'm starting yeah. to use my emotional hurt as a justification for my actions towards my partner
yeah.
and a justification of trying to demand from my partner that they do certain things for me that love would not demand.
Mm-hmm.
Only injury and unloving behavior would demand it.
Yeah.
And when I'm doing this to my partner, I'm harming my partner's condition. I'm harming their concept of love of self, but I'm also harming my own soul further.
Yeah.
Yep. So this is not the way to handle your hurt self.
No. And it's sad, isn't it? We know people who are very, very caught up in the hurt that was done to them in childhood,
mm-hmm.
but they're not feeling it. They're
no.
expecting their environment, their partner, to take responsibility for it.
Yes.
To that, or as you mentioned earlier, almost blame their partner. When their partner expresses any truth
yes.
about their situation and their responsibility now for
to
their
feel
pain.
It.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which is also a truth.
Yeah. And they wander around kind of expecting their entire environment to commiserate
yes.
with this hurt. And that is a sure sign that they're not feeling their hurt and that they're wanting to avoid it.
Yes. Yeah. They want their addictions met with regard to this hurt.
Yep.
So, and part of their addictions is to hold on to seething resentment. That's
yeah.
one of their addictions, to hold on to the hatred of the people who caused the problem and to hold on to seething resentment with society, the world, God, everyone. Everyone is in the firing line here generally.
Yeah.
And very destructive to a relationship, of course.
Yeah.
Very hard to hold on to a relationship with a person who's doing that. And it's also very frequent that these kind of people suppress their rage and therefore go into depression.
Yeah.
And so these kind of people become high maintenance, high management mm-hmm. relationship people
yeah.
where they either revert to manic depression or which is codependent depression with spirits
mm-hmm.
involved, or depression itself,
mm-hmm.
which is just the suppression of their internal rage and anger with the world and or with things generally. Or schizophrenia, where they now have spirits influencing all of their decisions and they can blame spirits for their unloving yeah. behavior and so forth.
Yeah.
A lot of these mental illnesses are the result of a person in this state and actually harm the people around them quite intensely.
Yes.
Including their own children.
Yeah.
Quite
yeah.
badly. Yeah.
Yeah. So that in this state, a person actually wants from their relationship for their partner to be responsible for their emotional
pain. Of course.
Yeah.
They want their spirits, God, their partner, any person they meet on the street to be responsible for their emotional hurt. They want God, their partner, their children, any person they meet on the street to feel their emotional pain. Before they feel any of their own. They want their partner, God, the world, their children to be responsible for cheering them up and making them happy and doing everything they want.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Very selfish people.
Yeah.
Very destructive people with regard to relationships.
Yeah.
Yeah. Very common, unfortunately.
It is. So let's now talk, I mean, it's fairly obvious how this is detrimental to one's partner relationship, but let's run through some of the specifics we've listed. Yeah. So when we live in our hurt in this way, we end up punishing the people around us for it. And we've said this earlier.
Yeah, so we're basically saying you're to blame for what somebody else did to me.
Yes.
That's what we're doing. How unfair is that?
It's very unfair. And we're missing the point that the cause of all of our pain comes from our childhood.
Comes from this, what this other person did before I met this person.
Yes.
Yeah. This, what this other person did before I met you caused my pain, and yet I'm blaming you for it and punishing you for it.
Yeah.
And punishing you when you don't share in it. Yeah. Like even me wanting you to share in it.
Yes.
How bad's that? It's like I have all this pain inside of myself. And to be happy, I need you to be in the same amount of pain that I'm in.
Yes, terrible.
Ooh, very dark emotion, isn't it?
Yeah.
Very dark emotion.
And obviously it's going to have a fairly repelling effect on your partner if you're behaving in that way.
Of course.
Yeah.
Sooner or later, your partner's not going to be able to tolerate that behaviour.
Yeah.
And
they're going to seek distance emotionally, physically, or just end the relationship.
Yeah, this is one of the main reasons why men go fishing.
Yeah.
Like, because he doesn't want to feel the unexpressed or expressed hurt, living in hurt, partner. All he does, all he wants to do is get away from her.
Yeah. And it's another reason why women encourage their daughters to have emotionally incestuous relationships
with
their fathers, because the woman doesn't want to deal with the emotional projection coming from her husband all the time, and she's happy if the little girl
deals with some
bees the shoulder to cry on and absorbs some of the pain and all of those kinds
of
things.
Be daddy's favourite and everything.
Yeah.
And it's vice versa with the mummy, with her son.
Yeah.
Exactly the same.
Yeah.
Causes terrible problems in your entire life, but also causes a severe degradation of your own condition again.
Yeah.
This, you know, people who live in their childhood hurt become people who stay in the hells for many, many years, justifying their cruel punishment and behaviour towards other people.
Okay. So when we live in our hurt, we impose the qualities and nature of our hurt emotional beliefs onto our partner's gender.
Yes.
About my partner's gender, rather onto my partner.
Partner's gender. And also any children that I have of
the same gender. So maybe if we just expand that a bit, because I muddled saying it.
Yeah.
So I'm living in my hurt.
Yes.
And so,
with regard to how the opposite sex has treated me, my partner's gender has treated me.
Yeah.
So I could be in a homosexual or heterosexual relationship, but I'm living in all my hurt about how my partner's gender has treated me.
Treated me. So then I am going to project onto my partner that they are all of my hurt beliefs about that gender.
Correct.
I'm going to project onto my partner and say, you're exactly like that.
Correct.
And you're bad because of this, or you're going to act like this because of some hurt I'm holding
on
to.
And even if you don't say it, you're going to believe it.
Yep.
You're going to not be able to trust them. You're not going to be able to open to them. You're not going to be able to, you know, sincerely express yourself emotionally to them because you're living in this hurt.
Yeah. And again, this is something that is so incredibly common, isn't it? We see this all the time. Okay. Now let's flip it around. When I allow my partner to live
with me
in their hurt rather than dealing with it, I allow them to take their hurt out on me.
Yes, which is not loving yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a huge issue with regard to love of self.
Yeah.
If you allow a person to take all of their emotional hurt out on you when you have not been the cause of it, then that is very, very unloving to yourself. And God can't agree with that. You need to get out of that relationship quick, smart. because to love yourself, you have to.
Yeah.
Or you need to address it quite strongly with your partner.
Yeah. Yeah.
Your partner needs to stop doing it to you.
Yeah.
He has to stop doing it to you if you're ever going to have a decent relationship.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. All right. And I mentioned this one earlier. When either of us in the partnership live in our hurt, or both of us, we are going to have a distorted viewpoint of reality.
Yes.
We're going to see everything through the filter, if you like, of our past unfelt hurt.
Yes.
And it will colour. We won't even be in touch with reality from God's perspective.
Yes.
What we believe is happening.
Yes,
it is not necessarily.
And it's really weird how it affects people, because they think things are safe that are completely unsafe. They think things that are happy are that are completely like, oh, if you looked at it, you'd cry almost. Yes. Just looking at it, you know.
Yeah.
They believe things are in their welfare when it's totally the opposite.
Yeah.
You know, they believe that they're doing a good thing when they're doing terrible things. They believe they're doing terrible things when they do good things.
Yeah. It's very,
you know,
true.
It's really, that's a huge distortion of reality on their mm-hmm. part, and because of that they engage in a lot of very unloving behavior.
Yeah.
As a result of the distorted reality, they can't see themselves properly or their partner properly, and they certainly are not capable of having a relationship with the real self of their partner or themselves, and as a result it's just a terrible. Like, it's very unusual for these kind of relationships to last long.
Mm-hmm.
But when they do, the partner has to have a severe amount of lack of love of self.
Yeah.
To allow it. And I've been in a relationship like that where I allowed lack of love of self, I allowed that kind of behavior for many, many years.
Mm-hmm.
And in the end, once I realized what I was doing, I had to leave, of course. But I see many codependent people staying in those relationships for very long periods of time.
Yeah.
But it is very painful, very painful.
And it ends up affecting the self-worth. Like you said, you've got the lack of love of self, but your worth is continually
on the receiving end, yeah.
Because the person is blaming you or expecting you to absorb their hurt all the time. And,
yeah.
You know, I've been
depressed all the time, down all the time,
yeah.
In spirit influence all the time. Projecting at you a whole heap of things that are not true all the time.
Yeah.
It's just a constant battle to even stay in harmony with truth in
yeah.
that kind of a relationship yeah. on the receiving end of it.
Yeah.
And you know, if you're staying in that kind of relationship, I suggest to people, then you've got severe lack of love of self issues to address.
Yeah.
And once you address them, you won't stay. So this is the kind of, and the person who's doing it, you're destroying your relationship.
Mm-hmm.
You're destroying it. Like, there's no way that a person who loves themselves can live with you
yeah.
while you do this.
Yeah.
You've got to work through your hurt in a more proactive way, a way that doesn't harm other people. And the only way you can do that is by taking responsibility for the emotions of it and work your way through it by yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You're probably going to need a lot of time by yourself to do that. If you're doing this in a relationship, you probably need to be out of the relationship for a while and work through this terrible feelings that you have about blaming the world for your pain.
Yeah.
Which is a very resentful feeling towards everyone in the world, including your partner.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you're going to blame someone, blame the people who caused it.
Yeah.
It's very irresponsible of you to blame anybody else. But if you're going to be angry, you can be angry for thousands of years like this. And you can be in suppressed depression for thousands of years too, by the way,
mm-hmm.
while you retain this kind of behavior. My suggestion is get out of it as soon as you can, because it's terrible for relationships, it's terrible for your own happiness, and it's also terrible because it creates a degrading soul condition.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Which is going to be very harmful for your future.
Yeah.
So yeah, I just encourage people to get out of that state as soon as they possibly can.
Yeah. Yep.
Mm.
There's quite a lot of anger in that state, isn't there?
Lots of anger yeah. in that state, whether it's passive aggressive or aggressive, lots of anger in that state.
Yeah.
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 Or suppressed, like depression, which is mm-hmm. very suppressed, passive aggressive or aggressive anger.
Yeah.
Like, so yeah, even people who are depressed are really severely angry.
Yes.
And a lot of it's because they're just living in the hurt,
mm-hmm.
not experiencing it, not expressing it. When I say expressing it, not feeling it for themselves.
Yeah.
Not experiencing it for themselves. Wanting everyone around them to be responsible for it.
For it.
Yeah. Yeah. Terribly destructive to a relationship.
It is. Mm. It is. In fact, it makes a relationship almost impossible.
Well, yes, unless the other person is in a severe condition of lack of self-love,
yeah.
a relationship will be impossible.
Yeah.
But if the other person is not, is in a severe condition of lack of love, they'll tolerate that behavior for many years. And I've seen people tolerate it for their entire life.
Yeah.
For religious reasons, not, mm-hmm. not. They, you know, they can't tolerate their relationship, but they stay in the relationship for religious reasons, believing mm-hmm. that they are doing God's will, or, you know, that yeah. they made their bed, they have to lie in it, or
yeah.
or that, you know, marriage is, they married the person and now they got to pay for that the rest of their life. Completely untrue.
Yeah.
All of these things are completely untrue, but that's the main motivations for people to stay in those kind of relationships.
Yeah.
They
yeah.
don't stay because they love the person.
No.
Because by that time, all semblance of love has disappeared.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so living in our hurt is severely detrimental.
Mm-hmm.
And mentioned a lot of points there about why it's so.
Yes.
That's the end of our session today, session four.
Mm.
So we've covered a lot of good bad habits.
Good bad habits.
Good bad habits to avoid. We've covered many bad habits to avoid if you want to have a good
relationship. Yeah. And these bad habits have the effect of ruining any kind of possibility for having a good relationship.
Yeah.
And that's why they're so important to address personally. So these bad habits are personal, individual bad habits.
Mm-hmm.
They are things that exist within oneself. We need to address them within ourselves. If both parties have a desire to address our own individual bad habits, then we have a hope of having a great relationship.
Yeah.
But if both parties or one party decide to avoid addressing these bad habits, then it's going to be put a lot of strain on our relationship. And it's going to be, and by the way, we're not asking our two primary questions or our four supplementary questions if we do this.
Yes.
And we're certainly not living in harmony with humility, love, truth, and the proper use of our will when yeah. we do this.
Yeah.
So what can we expect? Of course we're going to have a bad relationship.
Yeah.
So if you want to have a good relationship, my suggestion is avoid these bad habits. When I say avoid them, I don't mean to ignore them.
Mm.
I mean to deal with them, address them, feel them emotionally, work through the issues, treat each other as friends and work through each one of these bad habits that each of you have individually. You might not be able to see your own bad habits and you might be able to see some of your partner's bad habits. Work through that. You know, and if you can't see, both of you can't see your bad habits, you're in a codependent addiction, work through that with God. But you desperately need to do it. Otherwise, your relationship will not be good for a long period of time if it survives at all.
Yeah.
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 So we'd like to thank everyone for their time today and thank the guys who have been filming us all day and switching back and forth between our often rapid fire conversations.
Yeah.
And we hope you've enjoyed our session. And the next time we get together with these sessions of on partner relationships, we are probably going to start dealing more with issues with regard to children and breakups of relationships. And then we'll start looking at individual questions that people have asked us about their personal relationships.
Yeah.
Thanks for your time, guys.